world-renowned immunology experts at the Kimmel Cancer Center at Johns Hopkins, whose decades-old theories that a cancer patient's own immune system would one day attack and destroy cancer cells has finally arrived. Immunotherapy is being called a game changer for some cancers, and for some cancer patients, it's a whole new world of treatment and success. Suffering from metastatic colon cancer, Stephanie's options were slim and none, until she connected with Dr. Luis Diaz and his immunotherapy clinical trial.
I get a call from a 410 number, and obviously I see Baltimore. Obviously I knew it was someone from Hopkins, and I almost didn't answer the call. And my parents, and I'm sitting in this room, like, just completely, I mean, discouraged doesn't begin to explain it, but I just was ready to give up. And I get this call. My mom's like, answer it, of course answer it. But I'm like, the surgeon's gonna walk in, what do I do? And thank God I did, because I always tell you the story, and I really mean it from the bottom of my heart, but you saved my life on that phone call, because that was a lifeline to me. When you picked up the phone and you said, get over here as soon as you can, we've been having a lot of success with patients like you. And that was a lifeline, that really was, because I didn't have anything to hold on to at that time at all. I mean, when you have, you look up to the doctors, you know what I mean, you expect them to have answers, and when all of them don't, and they're kind of looking at you blankly, it's incredibly, incredibly scary.
What was the situation?
So the situation was, I was actually at, you know, I had operated twice at this point. You know, I was diagnosed with stage 2B about a year prior, had, you know, my colon resected, and then 8 months later popped up that it had metastasized into my abdominal cavity. Operated again, that was a really rough recovery for me, and then at that point went to receive further treatment, because the doctors basically said, this is now stage 4 disease and you have to do chemotherapy in order to prevent, you know, just to make sure we have all the microscopic cells. So as I'm on this chemotherapy, I was on the FOLFOX regimen, we see that the cancer came back for, I guess, a third time, where like really didn't leave, right? So at that point, they switched me to a more aggressive chemo. I was on FOLFIRI, and then the tumor became totally inoperable in that time period. So that's when I reached out to all my network of doctors, and my doctor in Philadelphia was like, I have the perfect study for you, I think. Let me put you in touch with Dr. Luis Diaz. So,
and
yeah.
And then I think I spoke to your sister, is that right?
So, no, I think, so my sister, actually, she, you know, when the surgeon basically told my parents and I, my whole family, like, there's nothing I can do for you guys, you would have a 2-5% chance of making it off my surgical bed. Sorry, best of luck to you. They basically just didn't have any more options for me at that institution. Jess, my little sister, went home and just researched the entire, just scoured the entire internet. She found your trial, and then my other doctor who I, you know, had talked to as well, just confirmed, like, yes, this is a wonderful study. So actually Jess was the one who found it, and then my other doctor just kind of confirmed that.
And then you met Dr. Lee, met me, and Dr. Lee always criticized me because I tell patients, we're going to cure you.
I know, right?
And everyone thinks I'm crazy.
No, but was necessary at the time. You didn't say I'm going to cure you, but you were like, get over here. I guess a lot of people don't realize is the amount of pain that comes with cancer.
When I met you, how much did you weigh?
When you met me, I weighed about 102 pounds.
And how much, you were on a lot of narcotics.
Yeah, I was taking between 120 and 140 milligrams of oxycodone a day, on top of the fentanyl patches that I was wearing.
And hardcore narcotics, yeah.
I didn't want to be taking those drugs at all. So what happened was I almost, within 5 days, started to feel some sort of relief in my back. I really did. And again, not a conscious thing that I was like, I'm not going to take these. I just needed to take them less. So I did take less of them and didn't realize that although my mind wasn't addicted to these drugs, my physical body indeed was. And I'm heading to this appointment and my mom looks at me and I'm so white in the face. I hadn't been able to eat all that day. And she goes, you look really unwell. And my heart is beating.
So let me pause you.
Yes,
can anyone
please.
Guess what's going on? So, right, yeah, she's going through.
So I'm going through withdrawal, not knowing, and I wouldn't know for the
major
next 3 days.
Major
withdrawal. I mean, my heart is beating so fast. I'm put in front of the line, in front of every, so I go, instead of going to like another, go to the ER, and my heart is beating so fast, they basically, they put me in front of everybody else, and they're like, do you have a history of heart failure in your family? And I'm like, no, I don't. And I'm thinking it's immunotherapy that's killing me. And they basically strip down all my clothes, like put all this stuff on me, all these monitors, and I'm just shaking. I mean, convulsing in my seat or in the on the bed. And no one's putting it together. No one's like, have you been taking less of your narcotic? Nope. They are just telling me that it could be this new drug that I'm on. So I'm in the ER, and I guess I calmed down after a few hours because I got a little bit more of the oxycodone. And that's basically what happened. I mean, I was just completely going through withdrawal symptoms.
So she's in New York and we're in Baltimore, and Dr. Lee, who's the PI of the study, has to notify me because I'm the sponsor that something's going on with her patient. That also happened to be my patient. And, you know, she's sick, and we don't know if it's a study drug. Could it be an infection? Could it be an adverse reaction?
Yeah.
But it turned out to be you were withdrawing from drugs.
Yes.
Despite your harrowing start to the therapy, describe how the journey proceeded after that.
Then what happened was I developed some sort of, like, thyroiditis situation.
That's not uncommon. So
yeah.
What happens is you're releasing the brakes on the immune system.
Right.
Not only to fight your tumor, but if you happen to be predisposed to your immune system attacking your skin, you might get some rashes or diseases like pemphigus.
Mm-hmm.
If you're predisposed to having an immune reaction against your GI tract, you're predisposed to certain inflammation of the colon or liver or the pancreas. And in your case, it was your thyroid.
Yeah.
And so that was something we had to watch closely.
Yeah, that was difficult. I was definitely, you know, really lethargic. I could not do anything for a little bit of time. But again, because just talking to Dr. Lee and to you, I just felt really confident that, you know, this was working. Like, yes, I was going through a difficult period, but that was going to pass.
Any other issues? Joint pain?
So joint pain, yeah, that's something that I started to experience later on. I would say like a year in, I started to experience some joint pain in my knees, which I still have a bit of, but it hasn't gotten worse. So it's kind of stabilized, and it doesn't really affect my life. I mean, if we talk about all the side effects from chemotherapy, I mean, I will take the joint pain in my knees. So I am about to be done therapy.
And what does done therapy mean?
Done therapy means I will be under high surveillance, but I will not be coming in for infusion every 2 weeks. So yeah, the protocol, I guess, is a full 2 years, which is...
So you've been on therapy for 2 years.
I've been on therapy for 2 years.
And when I met you, what was the last piece of recommendation from a doctor before we talked?
they basically just told me that I wasn't responding to these treatments, that they had nothing else to offer me, but that there was interesting stuff being done in immunotherapy was my recommendation.
So that interesting stuff has actually, you've had a major response.
Yes.
What's the status of your tumor right now, according to your understanding of it?
Yeah, according to my understanding of it, I am NED, which is no evidence of disease, which, to be honest with you, I never thought I would hear those words on ever. My tumor shrank by, I think, like 60, 65% within 3 months.
Right.
That was my first scan. And then it shrank a little bit more and a little bit more, and then it had sort of stabilized. And then in February of 2016, just this year, my scan that month came back, no evidence of disease.
Well, what's extraordinary about this is that at the point that we met, you'd failed all standard therapy.
Yeah.
There was no really other viable options, and clinical trials were the options that she had to pursue. And we know in general, clinical trials only work about 4% of the time. And by work, it doesn't mean make the tumor disappear.
Right.
It's using to control the tumor for a period of time. In this case, you're here 2 years later. The tumor is not visible by any modern technology. And you're about to go off drug.
Yeah.
And really ride with no training wheels anymore. What we're looking for is if the tumor will stay away.
Yeah.
We're going to be looking for that together. How do you feel about that?
It's incredibly terrifying because, like, what evidence do I have that supports the theory that my body will be okay on its own? You know, ever since I was diagnosed in January 2013, like, this has been a part of my life. I don't know if the cancer ever went away. Like, I know we say, like, oh, it came back, but, like, did it ever even go away? So it's a really scary time. I think being this therapy has definitely been a big, like, crutch for me, you know, especially in the last year since I have been so well, just knowing that I have it as, like, support and backup just to make sure my body's in check has been a huge safety net. But the good news is that if there are two people I trust more in this world, it's just you and Dr. Lee. And I know that, like, you guys will be able to navigate me through this unknown. And I trust you with my life, literally.
And we are going to watch you very closely.
Yeah.
And behind Dr. Lee and myself, there's a whole other team watching us.
That's good.
And checking up on us. So I think you've got a lot of people watching out for you.
So I haven't felt this well probably in, like, 5 years, which is obviously beyond incredible. But it does take a little bit of time for me to, like, fully comprehend how well I'm feeling because it was really difficult for so long.
We've been able to unite cancer genetics and immunotherapy in a kind of unique way.
Yeah.
And you're the perfect example of that. I think more and more of that's going to happen. But that doesn't mean that cancer genetics isn't important, and that doesn't also mean that immunotherapy is the only answer. We're going to have to find, there's a lot of other patients that aren't having responses.
I know, and that
kills me. And so we've got to improve how we're doing in terms of therapy with immunotherapy for so many other patients that aren't responding. There's a whole other arm to the study in patients that didn't have your genetic signature. And none of those patients responded.
I know, really.
And we need a solution for them. Now, the hope is that it will be innovation around immunotherapy. But that takes a lot of work, a lot of research, clinical trials, and nurturing and mentoring new scientists.
Yeah.
And willing patients like yourself.
Yeah.
And I think that we have the ingredients here. We just have to put them together.